Hassan Khoshtaghaza is the CEO of SatoshiPoint. They operate Bitcoin vending machines, and people can also purchase other cryptocurrencies at their vending machines all over the country, all over the world. He's been growing his business for several years now, and they've got more and more vending machine locations. They're also just about to launch a wallet on the App Store that will be available on Android and iOS devices. And in this interview, Hassan is going to tell us all about it. How are you doing today, Hassan?
Very well, thank you. Very good. And yourself?
Well, yeah, I'm good, thanks. And it's great to have you on the podcast. And we haven't caught up for like several years. You know, I remember when you started SatoshiPoint, and I remember when you first had a Bitcoin vending machine in Bristol. You know, I went and took a selfie next to it. But
I remember.
Catch us up with the story. What's been going on in that
time?
Well,
firstly, thanks for having me on your show. It's really nice to get the message from you, and that's really good. Since then, obviously, there's been loads of ups and downs. It's never straightforward, especially in the crypto space. There's so much drama, you know.
Yeah.
One minute everything's going amazing, and then the next minute, you know, is falling to bits. But generally speaking, we're going a few steps forward and a few back, couple back. So we've been adding more locations and new partnerships. We've been working on new services. Installing machines in new areas, and all the fun and games is involved in all of that, really.
Yeah, you got a lot on your plate. Why don't you take us back to the start? Let's go through the whole story. Like, where did this begin?
Okay, so yeah, the first beginning was that it was this 2012 or maybe a little at some point in 2012. I heard about it on TV. Very brief message. Took some interest into it, and funnily enough, I was asking another friend of ours from school, Jamie Shotland, asked him for some advice on how it all works, you know, in terms of the mining side of things, because that's what the show on TV was mentioning, that you needed special equipment and all this kind of stuff. And I took some interest there, but it wasn't like from day one I was fixed. It was, I took some interest, looked at it, and I was gaming at the time, so I had some GPU miners going. So I thought, oh, okay, let's just try and mine some Bitcoin and see what it's all about.
Wait a second, what's a GPU miner?
Well, a GPU is a video card that if you're a gamer, you would have it in your computer, and it's your video card, graphics card.
Right.
Okay. And you can, back in the day, you could use that to mine Bitcoin. Now, you can mine other things with it, but generally speaking, the Bitcoin network is so big and strong now, you need specialized chips to be able to mine Bitcoin now. ASICs chips, they're called.
Oh, okay. It's sort of solving the equations or something, is it?
That's correct, yes. And whoever's mining, obviously, each block is kind of mined every 10 minutes. And if you're participating in the mining and offering power from your computer, you get rewarded a share of the Bitcoin that's delivered every 10 minutes.
So in the early days, that was more worthwhile, was it? And then over time,
there's always been this kind of thing that is never really worth it. But yeah, generally speaking, if you were mining back then and if you kept hold of the Bitcoin, yes, it was very profitable.
I see.
But generally not, maybe at the time the price was very low and it didn't seem like it was worth going into. But obviously, later on down the line, it was.
Right. The market is so weird, isn't it? It's so unpredictable, and like no one knows if it's going up or it's going down. Like, how do you find that just from... Like, what's that like for you?
Well, obviously, as our business operates, we're not open to fluctuation. So, you know, everything's kind of hedged on the exchanges. We're working with dollars or euros or something like this, and the API buys it when the customer comes. So we're not open. We are to a little bit. Obviously, we do hold a little bit of crypto. But generally speaking, the network is protected in that way.
Right.
Obviously, there is crypto companies out there that do hold a lot of crypto and are affected by that.
I see.
But at the same time, there's obviously stable coins out there that don't change in price, and you can obviously swap to those and not get affected by any short price falls or anything like this.
I see. So your business model is really dealing with the transactions as opposed to speculating and buying and, you know.
Exactly.
Right. Yeah. I'm with you. Yeah. Yeah. So So at what point did you decide to go into business and get the machines?
Okay, so yes, that was obviously the mining side of things was really exciting for me. You know, it's these devices. As time went on, you had to basically pre-order your ASICs chips or your miners. But the problem was, obviously, when you made a pre-order, they never delivered on time. So you would have to pay for your hardware first and then wait 6 months for the delivery date, but then it was 3 months or 4 months later. And then the difficulty of Bitcoin went up and you would never get your predicted amount of Bitcoin for leaving your machines on. So it just seemed like it was never going to be a business, you could never make it into a business. This was more of a hobby at the time, but you could never make it into a business to be able to, you know, if your delivery of your hardware is not going to come, it's like, you know, this is not going to work. And then I literally online, I noticed that the first Bitcoin ATM was ever made was in Canada. Or the US, sorry, but a shop in Canada had the first ATM. So I was like, wow, this is interesting, and this could do it. So I actually purchased one. And I noticed on Twitter that somebody in London, Johnny Bitcoin, also purchased one on the same day. And I thought of the name Satoshi Point, and I thought, wow, it'd be nice if I could join up with somebody that's already bought one like Johnny, and, you know, we could possibly work together and build a company out of this and get more locations, and we'll launch with two locations rather than one in London and one in Bristol or something along these lines. And that's the starting point, really, where it happened, and we thought maybe we could have a few locations, and now, yeah, it's turned into, obviously, putting the plans and foundations down so we can have hundreds, if not thousands, of locations. That's the plan, but obviously, you know, if we can get to that stage, it'd be good.
How many locations do you have now?
We've currently got 40.
Wow, incredible. Now, like, the idea of getting a Bitcoin machine, like, that's way out of my comfort zone. I wouldn't even know where to begin. So are you, like, a tech computer person? Like, do you understand that? Or, like,
to a level, but I'm not a coder. I can't exactly, you know, I read the white paper, but I can't look at the code, and, you know, I'm not a coder, developer. But I have a fairly good idea of stuff, but yeah, to a certain level only, you know. I could do a few small coding things, but nothing major. My brother's on the team, Hossein. He's now basically making the websites and working on the app that we've just launched this week.
Right, okay.
So we've launched Satoshi Wallet app, which is like a multi-cryptocurrency wallet, as well as an ATM directory. So you can find all the ATM locations that's in your area, the prices, what's online. You can also exchange your crypto to crypto as well in the app. And then we've got like some really exciting features coming out later on.
So these machines, do you just buy them and they're already working, or did you like have to have it specially developed to do what you want it to do?
So we've worked with a couple of manufacturers. So some manufacturers obviously have the software provided. Some of them are open source and depend on you creating some bits and pieces to make it better. But yeah, so the software license we have, and obviously we have a partnership with a couple of manufacturers. We do kind of develop it to our liking, but generally speaking, it can be used out of the box, yeah.
Oh, I see. So it's not you don't just buy it on Amazon. It's not that simple. I mean, I'm kind of joking, you know. But
no, yeah. No, it's not. But in one respect, it is. Yeah, you can go online and buy one with Bitcoin, and it'll be delivered soon. But
right.
Yeah, there's a lot more other stuff involved than just buying the machine and putting some Bitcoin in the wallet and turning it on. But generally speaking, you could do that, yeah.
Yeah, I see. Now, what's the current... I'm not aware what's the latest news with crypto. I don't really keep up with it. I don't keep an eye on it. So what's going on in the market, in the industry?
Okay, so I'm so kind of... got my head stuck in this so much that I'm kind of missing out on some of the information these days. So there's no hot tips available or nothing like this, but... at the moment, obviously, there's so much going on. There's always something going on in the Bitcoin network or the cryptocurrency industry. Yeah, I don't know where to start. Are we talking about the prices or new coins?
Well, I mean, I just like is it being adopted? Like, is there more and more uptake and volume of transactions, or is it tailed off? Like, where is it at?
Yeah, so like in respects of our company, it's continuing to rise, but I'm sure there's other areas of the industry where it's not doing so well. Obviously, with the price kind of generally going down since last Christmas, it's the time for other. There's loads of businesses developing and doing new stuff at the moment, but there's also some businesses that are suffering with the last year's worth of performance. So it's a mixed bag. It's a mixed bag. But all in all, the industry, the infrastructure is all kind of building up, building up. You know, obviously the price went crazy nearly 2 years ago. Obviously went to 20,000. From the next bull run that happens, you know, there will be a much larger infrastructure there to handle it. And we should continue to rise, I believe. But
What are the other applications of blockchain besides using it as a money medium of exchange?
So there's I was at a conference not too long ago, and obviously you can use the blockchain, which is powered by Bitcoin, really, for all different types of industries. It can be used for all sorts of things, really. Just trying to think of something now.
I mean, is it being used, or is it still kind of future theoretical stuff?
I believe there is industries using it for different types of things. I'm just trying to give you an example now, Ben. I can't think of any right this second. So it has to be the way, doesn't it? But yeah, it's not just about money. You know, you can use it for all sorts of ways of being able to keep track of things, log in things that you don't want to be deleted, and to stay on the chain of on the blockchain. But you can share news and you can do all sorts of things. Not just it's a transaction can take place, and it doesn't have to involve money. It can involve anything really, commodities or
So it can transmit any kind of information, just like the information that gets transmitted over the internet, like.
exactly, for private messaging and all this type of stuff. Yeah.
All right, so that can all be done. Yeah, is there like messenger apps currently on smartphones that use that or not? I don't know how it works, really.
I believe so. I don't use any of them, but I believe I did read the other day that there was some messaging app that's using it. And there's also like blockchain phones. Again, I can't tell you too much information about that, although we do have an ATM in one of their locations in Mayfair. So it's Sirwin Labs. They've got a blockchain phone out. I believe it costs maybe £1,000 for an Android phone. And it has some privacy button on there that you can basically make sure that no one's eavesdropping on you.
Oh,
I don't know how they're getting on, to be honest with you. I haven't even been into the shop or seen the phone, but is it interesting? It's interesting to see what's behind the phone and
so
how it works.
that's actually transmitting your voice conversation via the blockchain rather than through the cellular network, the conventional network.
I believe so, but again, I haven't read the features, and I've been meaning to go visit them and speak to them about it. Obviously, it's got to be something quite clever, but again, I'm not sure exactly how it all works.
Yeah. What's your long-term plans with the business?
So long-term plans with the business, obviously we want to build up the network, the ATM network that is, and have obviously, you know, locations in every town, city. Along with that, we want to complement the network with our wallet that we've just released, which will obviously build up in features as we go along. As well as we want extra services on top of that. So we're looking at bureau de changes, giving the ability for fully verified customers to be able to transact on their phone and complete the transaction at the bureau de change for multiple fiat and cryptocurrencies. And on top of that, later on, a card service as well. So you'll be able to download the apps, you'll be able to verify yourself, and you'll be able to use the ATM network, the OTC network, as well as card services. So you'll be able to order a debit card. So right. Generally speaking, we're not a bank, but we're offering all the services that could a bank offers, if you like. We're not holding any of the client's money. We're basically just offering a free wallet where you can store your own money with your own private keys. You can deposit cash, your cash, into the ATM and have an instant credit onto your mobile phone wallet, as well as cash out as well. You can pair a debit card to it, or if you wanted to do a larger volume transaction, you can go to the bureau to change. Giving you full control of your money. That's kind of the vision that we're going for.
Do you have to jump through regulation hoops in order to do this stuff?
Yes, by all means, yeah. So we have to speak to lawyers and bits and pieces, and so we're kind of changing our structure at the moment. We've got a bit more of an international presence. And for the ability for us to scale, yeah, we've had to structure it in such a way. It can't just be a UK company that does everything, you know. So it has to be kind of structured in a certain way.
Right. So the tax structure and the corporate structure's got more complicated as you've gone along, has it?
Indeed, yes. Yes. And then it involves all the AML and KYC and...
What's that?
Anti-money laundering and know your customer. Registered customers, you know, monitoring and this kind of procedures have to take place to be able to operate. And as we scale, we need all of this in place, you know.
Oh, I see. Right. Jesus Christ. So it becomes like a more of a legal operation than like a crypto operation in a way.
Yeah. So obviously when I first started Bitcoin, it was very like, you know, there's no permission to do anything, you know, you can just go and do it and you don't need permission. But yeah, as you build a business and build up, there's obviously you have to take on all of these bits as well.
So presumably, like, who within SatoshiPoint, who's in charge of like the marketing and branding and, you know, public relations and that kind of thing?
Well, as we're restructuring the company and building the team, so since up until now, there's been like, you know, we've had a very small team, and now we're just bringing more and more people on. So we've just got a new person in charge of that. So yeah, we've used multiple avenues, and we're still building the company as we speak now. So in terms of roles, you know, we're just building it up now. So it's been a journey, but it's only just started, really.
Yeah, right. I can imagine the amount of work you've put in. I mean, I know how much work I do just fucking teaching handstand classes. I can't imagine what you must be doing, having vending machines all over the world and all the legal compliance and all that.
Yeah, sure. It's a minefield, but we've got so far now, you know, there's no turning back, you know, we've got to keep on going. So
yeah. So you're the leader, right? You're the CEO, is that
I am the CEO, yes.
So all the decisions are come from you ultimately.
Yeah, more or less. Yeah.
Yeah. So what was your background? Because we weren't in touch. We went to school together, but then, you know, I didn't see you for 10, 15 years. So what did you do in that time, prior to SatoshiPoint?
Well, I've done a few things. It was not in the financial industry either. So obviously I was working with my dad. He's got some fish and chip shops. So I was working there for a part of it. And also I was chefing in Park Street as well in Bristol. That was really early on though. Since then, obviously, I did some property work. My dad as well, that was relating to some businesses, some houses. We were doing some up and flipping them over. Whilst I was doing that, obviously I was kind of just taking some interest in other areas, and I come across Bitcoin. And yeah, slowly as it happened, obviously there was moments where I didn't touch it or look at it for a long time, but once I started to understand it, it just took up all my time. I just wanted to learn more and more. And I had this feeling inside me that this is the way, this is the future, you know, this is going to be really special later on, and I want to be involved with it. And as the mining started going okay, you know, I had a couple of, even though the hardware was delivered late, I still made some money from that, and I was like, wow, like, you know, I want this as a full-time position. I wasn't too sure where I was going to direct myself, but I was like, I want to be involved in this. From there it's just kind of took over, and I didn't want to really do any other type of job, really.
So what drives you in terms of what excites you about it? Is it the idea of making money? Like, why does it interest you?
Well, before I kind of wanted people to use it and be aware of it and, you know, adopt it. I could see this being like the internet of money, you know, so I still think that as well. I think maybe this type of money will be used on the internet, will be a standard, and debit cards and all this kind of way of payment will slowly fizzle out, because there's no kind of fraud involved, you know, there's no personal details being sent over from party to party, you know, it's just the payment. And it's got lots of qualities like that. So I believe I could just see it being the one, and I would like to just be involved in it. I don't know. I just...
Are you referring to cryptocurrencies in terms of all cryptocurrencies, or are you referring to Bitcoin specifically?
Well, Bitcoin specifically. Obviously, there is probably other currencies out there that might do a better job in terms of speed and stuff like this, but generally speaking, Bitcoin is the king, and this always has been. I am kind of a Bitcoin maximalist. Like, I prefer Bitcoin over everything else, but generally speaking, you know, it's the king of all cryptos. This is going to be moving forward.
You said your wallet app can handle different currencies. Can the vending machines sell different currencies?
Yeah, sure. So we have, at the moment, we have six different cryptocurrencies on there, and one token as well. So you can buy Bitcoin, Litecoin, Ethereum, Monero, Dash, and DAI, which is like a stable coin, which is a Ethereum token, ERC-20 token. Which basically stays at the price of $1 and never moves, which is another interesting concept. Although no one's really ever really took it on so far. So it's on the machine, but no one really buys it, to be honest, at the moment.
I see. So it's pegged to the dollar.
Yes, that's correct.
Oh, I see. So there's no chance of it like appreciating, you know, like tripling overnight or anything.
No, there's no chance of that happening. But, you know, I thought it would be a good move, because obviously, you know, if the prices are very volatile on that specific day and you wanted to go to the ATM and buy some, it might make sense to buy DAI and wait until you get home to exchange it to Bitcoin, just so you don't lose any money.
I see, because it's stable.
Yes, exactly, yeah.
Right, I see. And then I'm guessing you make your money on the spread, on the transactions, do you?
Yes. So you go to the ATM, you buy some crypto, and we have a little commission for the convenience of the transaction. Yeah.
Oh, by the way, how did you choose the name? What does Satoshi Point mean?
So the name was thought up, again, actually, with a little bit of help from a friend, but we were kind of thinking of how it could be. I was looking at the name Cash Point. Obviously, you look at the name Cash Point and you're like, okay, everybody knows what a cash point is. And going back to the roots of Bitcoin is obviously the developer, or the guy that introduced it. His pseudonym was Satoshi Nakamoto.
Oh, okay.
Okay, so, and generally speaking, we work in bits. You know, like a unit of Bitcoin is a Satoshi.
Oh, right. I didn't know that.
Yeah, so like, you know, pounds and pennies, so like a Satoshi. So, you know, if there is mass adoption and everybody is using Bitcoin, you wouldn't be buying a whole Bitcoin, you know, because the Bitcoin price would be too expensive. So you're buying in Satoshis. So Satoshi Point, Cash Point, it just felt like it was the one, you know. When we thought of it, it was like, wow, this is the
So,
one.
I'm wondering, just to explain, what's the actual drawbacks or risks? Because I'm a person, I know what Bitcoin is, I kind of understand it, you know, probably better than average. And yet, for whatever reason, I've never used it, you know. So, what's the pros and cons of using crypto?
Pros and cons. The pros, obviously, you've got your money on you. If you've got some awareness of how to look after it, you know, is much more secure than leaving your money somewhere else, for example. I need to think about this question. We'll have to edit this bit. the pros and cons of using cryptocurrency, it works both ways. Obviously, the pros of using it is you're in control of your own money. That money can obviously go up in value. There's all these different types of services. You're open to an open market, so obviously you can deal with somebody the other side of the world, and not have to rely on banking to be able to send the payment. The no extra fees, or it takes days to arrive. It can arrive instantly, or nearly instantly, should I say. The cons of Bitcoin or other ones is that you may lose some value if the price goes down. I'm not too sure of any more cons.
And it like if someone steals, like if they steal your password and steal your Bitcoin, there's no recourse, there's no way of getting it back, there's no.
Well, yeah, that's a con. Yeah, sure. So obviously, if somebody steals your Bitcoin, your Bitcoin is gone. There's nobody to ask for it back, unfortunately.
I'm guessing you probably, there must be some horror stories of people that like during the 20 grand, the 20K peak in December 2017. Do you know people that kind of borrowed money, put it on credit card, and did that whole thing and then got unstuck?
Yeah, there was lots of situations. Some close friends bought in, hoping that it's going to keep on going, and it never, and it went down. So it teaches me lessons not to try and get everybody involved in it, you know. So I've kind of, you know, if somebody wants to, that's fine, but I'm not going to try and push them into it, or kind of keep on telling them. But I think, yeah, there's lots of stories like that. I think you have to be careful. It's the same as like cash in your pocket with Bitcoin. It's a cash on the internet. You know, if you leave it out, if you leave it open, somebody's going to take it. So you have to keep it secure.
Do you know anybody that kind of had like major problems, like lost their house, you know, like really got in trouble?
Not majorly, no.
I suppose those are the kind of stories that hit the news in terms of people committing suicide because they borrowed money to buy Bitcoin and stuff.
Yeah, sure. I have heard stories that somebody got rid of their mortgage and remortgaged and tried to buy some and stuff like this. So it's happening, but they're not very close to me, so I don't know the full story. It's just kind of like rumors, you know. So you hear stuff at meetups and events, and somebody here has done this, that, and the other, lost their hard drive with thousands of bitcoins on and stuff like this.
And is there any it reminds me, you know those Derren Brown kind of memory things where you remember your password by remembering a story, like there's a cat sat on a tree and you know, do you remember your Bitcoin code like that or something, or do you just have it written down somewhere?
Yeah, I don't know. I have a few ways, but we shouldn't go into that.
Yeah,
I
don't right.
have. I kind of work with like random numbers, letters, and big things like that. Not necessarily any kind of stories or right. backward messages.
Oh yeah, yeah, yeah. I wasn't asking for your passcode, but I was just thinking like if I had to remember some code and you know somebody stole and I lost my computer, I'd probably have some way of remembering it. Like you know.
Yeah, sure, like sure. Yeah, you can print off your private key and you can split it up into multiple pieces. And you could basically store part of your private key in one place and then you could have the other part in another place, you know, just to protect yourself. So if you did lose it and you needed access to your private key, you could get it from different places. Or if someone tried to, you know, attack you or rob you, you know, they still can't get hold of the private key. So yeah, there's lots of ways to protect yourself, and there's also kind of like hardware wallets that are really good that you can store them on and write down a few codes and put it somewhere else separate to the hardware device and processes like this.
Yeah. That's the kind of thing that sort of scares people, isn't it? The idea of that people that are a little bit
sure.
nervous.
So you're about actually
that
looking after your money for real, you know. You're looking after your money for real. There's no one to like the bank's not looking after it for you. But like, you know, when your money's in the bank, you know, you don't really own it. They own it realistically.
Yeah.
So that's the difference, I suppose.
Yeah, wicked. So is this a full-time thing? I'm guessing, do you have other side projects or any other businesses, or is this your main focus?
Yeah, this is just 100%. This is 100% me working on this project, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Obviously, we have to work on the structures and the different side projects that are relating to this, but generally speaking, is all this, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, wicked. Is there any cool events or conferences or summits or stuff coming up?
This Friday, this weekend is CoinFest in Manchester, so we're taking an ATM up to there, and we'll be there for the 3 days that is on. So that's the next one, and then obviously, there's events going on all the time, and to be honest, where we're quite busy and we've got our work planned out, we've tried to visit some just to be sociable and to network and be with people, but generally speaking, you go to these events and you meet up with so many different people that want to either do something with you and get involved, you get a bit distracted from your main goals, you know, so... You always meet somebody that's doing a really exciting project and you're like, oh yeah, let's talk more. But realistically, you know, we've got our roadmap out there and we need to complete it. So but I do love going to events and networking and meeting people. It's really good.
Are you the kind of person that listens to like reads business books and reads leadership books and sales books and that kind of thing? Or are you more self-driven and self-directed?
Yeah, no. I love listening. I get an inspiration from people. I love watching like Gary V and stuff like this on Facebook. And I read books about that kind of stuff. Yeah.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Cool. I'm always curious because you know everyone's got their own different style and their own different approach, don't they? So.
Yeah, for sure. For sure.
It's like everyone seems to listen to Gary V. That's one thing everyone's got in common. You know, if you're in business, you listen to Gary V.
Yeah. He gets you out of that. If you're in a slightly lazy mode or something, I listen to him and I'm like, right, let's get on with this. Stop fannying about, you know.
Yeah.
Let's get on with it.
I like Grant Cardone as well. Do you ever see him?
Yes. Yeah, I do. I do watch a bit of his stuff. Funnily enough, actually, I don't know if it's a fake account, but he started following me on LinkedIn. I was quite surprised the other day. I just noticed. I don't know if he does that to a lot of people. I haven't looked at his account, to be honest with you. I said, wow, is that really his real account?
Oh, right. Yeah. Cool. Well, that's really interesting stuff, Hassan. Thanks for going into all that for us.
No problem. That's appreciated to be on here.
Yeah, you're good. Welcome. So everybody should look out for the Satoshi Point machines, and on the website, if they go there, there's a postcode thing, so they can, and a map, so they can find.
They can find their local ATM. They can also go to satoshipoint.io is our website. And obviously, you can go to the App Store or the Play Store and download Satoshi Wallet.
Okay.
iOS is not out yet, but it will be very, very soon. But Android is live now.
Okay. All right. That's awesome. Thanks for your time, Hassan. Good speaking to you.
No problem. Thank you, Ben. Cheers.
All right.
See you again.
Take care. Bye-bye.
Cheers. Bye-bye.